So we are an IT company, IT engineering services, product and services company. So we have been doing this kind of CSR for a long time, but we were doing very small scale initially. We had adopted a school and we had some engineers going over to that school, teaching and then building some infrastructure. So it was going at a very small scale. So when this ruling came that each company in India has to spend 2% of their profit on CSR initiative. So we decided that we do not just want to spend money on that initiative, maybe we want to add some more value as well. So we started thinking about what all various sectors, which are various communities where we can help, and we started doing some research, and then we looked at some of the statistics which are getting published every year, and we were actually shocked to know that we have got more than 1 million engineering graduates which pass out in India, and 70 to 80% of those engineers remain unemployed. And we found out that the course curriculum which is being taught in most of the engineering colleges is outdated. The technology is moving so fast these days that every 5 year, 10 year, there are new technologies, new platforms, new systems, and colleges, are engineering colleges are not able to keep themselves up to date. So we thought we will try to do something in this area. So we started doing a project where we picked up few colleges and we picked up students based on their socio-economic background, and we started doing a course in their seventh semester, and we started doing on-campus training program for them to start teaching them what all is required in the industry, what all the communication skills, because a lot of these colleges were not actually focusing on communication. So when the students come to interview, they're not able to present themselves because they're coming from rural background, they are not good in conversation, not good in English language, not good in other soft skills. So we picked up this program to spend our CSR initiative, CSR funds in education. And why also we picked up this? Because we realized that we have a lot of talent pool inside our organization. So in addition to spending money, we can also spend time with the students and teach them about how it is to work in the industry. What is it is required more than the education to work in the industry and grow and do well, and also interact with global clients, not just doing their work, but interact with the global clients. So based on that, what the talent we had, what the experience, knowledge we had, and where we can make a difference, we picked up this education in engineering colleges, and we also started looking at that the women engineering students in terms of ratio was very much skewed. We wanted to hire women engineering in our organization, but we couldn't find enough skilled women engineering students in the colleges. So through this initiative, we also made sure that 50% of the students actually are women engineering students.
I represent RPG at the D&I Forum, and I lead that for all the 7 companies. So we start from SEAT, which manufactures tires, to KEC, which is an EPC company, to Zensar, which is IT, and then to a specialty sector where you have plantation associates, people who actually go and, you know, pluck your tea or rubber and so on and so forth. And my organization, where I also head HR, which is a completely hardcore engineering electrical organization. So it's quite a variety, as you rightly said. What we do in the COE is to ensure what is the framework that we want to first run. And that's something which is common across all the 7 companies. So we are sure about the way we would do it probably would differ from company to company. But the framework remains the same. The governance remains the same. It has tremendous support from the management board, which is all the CEOs of the 7 companies and the chairman himself. So, you know, you have to build that ecosystem for support. But on the shop floor, to be very particular, it's extremely tedious exercise to get both women. And we do also a lot of work for people with disabilities. So in both these sections, to get them on the shop floor is a tedious job. And what we did as an experiment is to go to an NGO, of course, figure out what really works in every business. So for me, the example that I'm going to talk about is hiring of some disabled employees in an engineering firm, which is Rekim. And we ended up hiring a full batch, and they all are doing core work. And we needed support. We needed to understand what kind of disability do you want to really hire. There's no point in just talking about it and not knowing what you really want to do. So we engaged an NGO. We got them to assess us, find our infrastructure, where they are. And then we had to go and actually convince not only the employees who were deaf and mute, that's the category we focused on, to come and join us, but also their parents. Because it's extremely difficult for the parents to let go of a child with such a difficulty into an environment which is hardcore engineering. So there's a lot of counseling which we ought to do outside, which is the first step. A lot of counseling that we need to do inside. Are my managers ready for these kind of employees? Because the first thought which comes to our mind when we hire such kind of people, or even women for that matter, is safety. So how safe is the environment? Can I teach my managers to do sign language? So many things that we had to really build in inside. A lot of effort went in sensitization. It's a given. I think it's no more, it's like the first step for every initiative that you take. And that kind of helped us make it successful. The outcome today is we have a very successful batch, both women and disabled people, increased productivity by numbers. So you can't be talking to business and not talk numbers. So talk the language is what I keep telling my staff. We have zero absenteeism, which is a quite a common thing in especially in the manufacturing world. Zero attrition. So this is the best example we have set within Rekim, which now has been followed. This happened in Baroda, in the Halol factory. So now the Baroda commissioner also recognized us for this initiative. It's been taken as an example by two more companies within Baroda. It's impacting CET. CET has just hired another batch of such people. So we kind of trying to push the movement around.
Actually, a big round of applause.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, I think a lot of our programs are very similar to what Elson talked about. So we are a core manufacturing company and an engineering company. We have highly engineered products. So, and we have a global innovation center right here in India. So when we looked at our needs of doing innovation from here, one of the critical components for us was to get the talent that we need. And obviously get a talent which is diverse in nature so that they can then come together and create products for us over here. So obviously for us also, some of the technologies like hydraulics that we work, there's no formal course here in India to do that. So right from setting up like labs in universities to be able to do that, to sponsoring women engineers, actually we run a scholarship program for multiple years now for them. So that one, we are able to create our brand in their mind that this is a company which cares for them and they can come and work for us. So that is one aspect of it. And then right from there to even when we look at from a core business standpoint, as I said, you have highly engineered products. So you can't do that unless you have that level of talent coming in and working for you. So being able to partner with the educational institutions, running scholarship programs, going to them and like what they do, teaching them the kind of things we work upon. So starting from right over there, but what we are extending that to now is what are the feeders? So you talked about we talked about hiring more women in the workplace, right? And you do not have enough pipeline of women engineers coming out. So we are now also looking at right from the secondary schooling stage, so 8, 9, 10th, and then I'm an HR professional. I'm in no way a developmental profession, but there are people on my team who do a lot of development work. And what the education that they gave me, a lot of time our way as corporates are looking at a problem is that just push more women to do engineering, right? That's our way of. So my team told me the issues that you see as a corporate are not exactly the issues on the ground. When you look at pushing more women to do engineering, it's not about women not wanting to get into their career, it's about educating their parents, educating their family about making them do that and supporting them to do that.
What we saw was, and like you said, on the diversity agenda, our focus is very, very clear in terms of prioritization on gender diversity. What we have is a slightly different challenge. Our work pool school, and you know, at the bottom of the pyramid, we have actually a close to 50% diversity ratio. So the challenge is not there, quite obviously, and it's a global trend that we did see people drop off as you know, move up the chain, and we tried to figure out what's going on. In the context of India, we do different initiatives elsewhere. We realized that the time of maternity is a very important part, and a lot of the women drop off in the middle of the career. So we did two very focused, and actually if you think about it, they're very simple, but I guess we did launch them in a focused, structured manner, worked very well for us. One was the Returning Moms program, because in our industry, it's a global industry, you have to work 24 hours, you could have to work 24 hours, where we committed anyone going on maternity, when they come back to work, we will give them a schedule and a shift of their choice. What that led to was a very low attrition rate. People tended to leave their working careers after that, and a lot of people came back. We have a 96% deployment rate. We track this every month, every year, you know, across. So that led to a huge pool of middle managers who were women who continued their career. And the second one was where we launched a program called Returning Moms, Career 2.0, which was very, very specifically targeted at women, not from GenPact, anywhere, who had actually left their career midterm and, you know, maybe not worked for 5, 10, 15 years. That was a very interesting program because we suddenly had a supply pool available which no consultant had ever thought of tapping. The women in that had never thought they'd get another job at the same level at where they had dropped off. So it really opened up a whole new pool of people with experience who became available to us at short notice because they were excited to come back to work. And, you know, we're still continuing with that. We've had some great success in them taking on leadership role. So to